Hello, welcome to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay. I'm feeling very, very comfortable on my sofa today because I'm surrounded by friends who are involved in the food industry. And as everyone knows, I'm a professional fat lad. I'm joined here today by my good friend, Andrew Mosley, who is the manager of the Grand Brighton, our grand old dame of a hotel on the seafront.
That's right.
I'm also joined by Bryony Hill, who's a foodie friend, and converse regularly online about what we're cooking in our kitchens. Yes. And Bryony is cooking things that she's grown in her garden, which depresses me because I've got two plant pots and two very, very elderly looking weeds growing in them. And finally, I'm really excited to have Giles Cooper here because Giles is at the Theatre Royal this week, yeah, starring in Toast, the play version of Nigel Slater's novel. And I think it's important to say that it's a novel because it is a fictionalised version of some of his life.
Well, I mean, gosh, actually, there's a lot of truth in it, though, still. So, I mean, you know, but I think he sort of...
borders on the two.
Sometimes, yes.
Dangerously exactly. So. Wonderful. Now, we're all mad about food, I know that. But, Andrew, you're about to launch this week another Chef's Table event. Tell us a little bit about it.
That's right. Well, I suppose we nicked the idea, if we're honest. I think there's a very large and similar event in London that takes place. I'm sure there are others too, but I'd heard about this other event and so sort of sat down with some key members of my team, including our chef Alan White, and mm-hmm. said, how does it look if we bring four or five of the best local chefs in Brighton together, including Alan, and cook a meal.
He'll be so pleased that you've included him in four or five of the best, won't he?
Well, he is.
And he is good.
He is. But we brought the guys together in the first year, and on that occasion, they each cooked their own food to two tables of 10. So I think we had 10 tables. I think there were five chefs, maybe there were 12. I think
so depending chefs. On what table you got, you just got the one
That's
chef.
It. We had people then buy tables... at good money, because it all goes to charity, and they came along on the night. They didn't know who was going to cook for them. We called it out of a hat, and they all sat down, and then they were served their food from each relevant chef. In the second year, we did something similar, but this time we did it in our restaurant, so you could book a table of two or four, and the guys collaborated and worked together. And this year, we're doing more of a Christmassy theme back in our main function suite, where, again, five chefs are cooking a course each. This time it's a five-course meal with a wine flight, served at banqueting tables in our main suite with a bit of a Christmas...
That sounds much more fun to me, to get something from each of them that is their own style.
Yeah.
Rather than... Because, as you know, I mean, I've been reviewing restaurants here in Brighton now for 27 yes. years, which is a little bit scary, isn't it? Because I don't look that old. I know. That's what you're supposed to have said, not me. I have some favourite chefs that I love to go to, but I love the idea of getting something different throughout the evening. That's yeah. quite exciting.
Yeah. So they're each cooking a different course this time. So, you know, the meal, I'm sure they'll sit down and talk about the menu, but in theory, you're getting a very different experience potentially at each course.
Yes.
Even though, as I say, there's a Christmas theme running through it.
And let's face it, chefs have not only enormous palates, they have enormous egos as well, so they'll be all showing off, won't they?
Well, yeah,
they want everyone to leave saying, oh, the best course was the starter, oh no, the fish course was the best course. I think the main, they'll all want to be the star of the evening, so no one is going to send out a tomato salad.
No, they're not. No. I'm pretty confident that the food will be exceptional. I mean, it certainly has been in the last couple of years, and people have had an amazing night. So,
now, who's coming along this year?
Right,
who's
cooking? We've got, in terms of the people attending...
Oh, no, the chefs.
Oh, no, the chefs.
I don't care about the people coming.
We've got Alan. We've got Stephen Edwards. From Etch, yeah. We've got Duncan Ray, who's at...
From Little Fish Market.
We've got Kenny Tutt.
Brilliant.
Chef Kenny name, and now his own chef. Restaurant yes. in Withing. And we've also got our own Alan White. So we've got a fantastic group of chefs all cooking
together.
It's
fantastic.
There.
Well,
and we're very grateful, by the way, to them all, because they're giving up their time, they're giving up their costs, they're giving up...
Do they do that as well?
They
that's
do.
Interesting.
They do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So whilst we host it at the Grand, they're giving an enormous amount towards the evening.
Well, how many sitters? How many covers? That's the
We're
term.
Aiming for 200. We're aiming for 200.
So that is a large expense.
It's a very large expense.
Some of the world now will be doing the tomato salad.
It is. Yeah, well, no, they won't. Still, I can tell you that. But it is a big expense to them. And I think, you know, especially for the guys that are running small restaurants.
Yes.
Thinking...
Someone new to owning a restaurant like Kenny.
Yeah.
I mean, for him, this is a major investment.
He's coming out...
He must genuinely believe in the project.
Indeed. He's coming out of his work. He's leaving his... the responsibility of his own restaurant behind,
yes,
and putting that behind him for the night and giving up that time and coming to us. So, as I said, we're really grateful to them. It's collaboration.
Do we know who's cooking which course yet?
We do, but that will...
You're going to keep that secret.
Ah, that's a secret on the night. Yeah.
That just makes me want to go even more, you see.
You've got to.
Because I've eaten all of them food over the years. I know Stephen very well.
Stephen,
Kenny I've met.
Yeah.
I've not eaten his food, actually. Yet, so that will be interesting. But the others, I know their food really well.
Well, Kenny joined the team in the second year, so he won MasterChef.
Yes.
And then he joined the team in the second year when we did it in the restaurant, so he's now in that gang of chefs that are cooking it up this year.
Now, I came along to your restaurant last week because you had a grand hurrah.
Yes.
You've closed GB1.
Had a lot of supper.
And not closed for good. It's reopening in about, it must be 3 weeks' time now.
Well, I think
according to
two or three things, I think all restaurants kind of have a shelf life, and when you add in how competitive the foodie market is in Brighton and how competitive it's become in the last five or so years with, quite frankly, the advent of the guys we've just talked about, they've arrived in town since 2013 when we opened GB1. So GB1's nearly 7 years old.
Is it really that long?
Something new. Yes, it was February 2013.
I can't believe it's 7 years since I first tasted scallop popcorn.
We did. We've still got it.
And you've still got it on the menu.
Yes, we have.
Yeah. And you'll keep it.
And with the fond farewell goes the scallop popcorn, I think, as well.
That's, oh, really?
Yeah, that's
awful. That's tragic.
For someone else.
Both of you, are you restaurant goers? I mean, obviously in the evenings, Giles, you're on stage, so it's probably a sandwich from the local supermarket before you go
on.
If
I'm lucky, yeah,
if you're
absolutely.
Lucky. Absolutely. And Bryony, I know you're so passionate as a cooking at home.
Heard.
You don't go to restaurants very often, do you?
No, we've not seen you.
No.
I mean, I'm constantly in restaurants. I love going to restaurants. And people have said to me over the years, because I'm also passionate about cooking, they said, why haven't you ever opened your own restaurant? I said, because I like going to them too much. Mm-hmm. And also, I did, as a teenager, work in a hotel kitchen. And fun as it was, and it was fun,
yes,
I learnt very soon that actually I didn't want to do it for a living.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was quite happy to leave Guernsey and Hotel Le Douvre behind and go to art school, train to be a designer. It didn't get bad hands from washing up and cuts and burns from ovens and things like that.
Yeah, you need the burns.
Yeah, yes,
I've got them
do, yeah, do you get them in makeup for the show?
No, I worked in a production kitchen before I got this job.
Right.
So I used to work for some pastry chefs, and they would say the mark of a pastry chef is all the different sort of burns you've got all up and down your arm and stuff.
You look like you're self-harm. I mean,
you do.
They are so bad. You've got them as well. I've got them too. You can't see them, but I've got them.
I profess not having any burns. I leave the cooking to the experts.
Do you ever cook, Andrew?
I cook at home.
You do?
I love cooking at home.
Yeah,
I do cook at home. I like eating out too. Kind of, but I tend to eat out in places which are kind of the antithesis of everything that we do. So I just go somewhere
bag of
really
chips.
Simple. Yeah, somewhere where the atmosphere is great. But
nothing wrong with a bag of
food,
chips,
nothing wrong. Nothing
where I feel I'm getting value and you know, it's delivered well. But it doesn't have to be fancy, high-end food for me.
Absolutely. And the people always say to me, oh, your life must all be foie gras and caviar and truffles. It certainly isn't. And I'm quite happy at lunchtime at home to have a bowl of homemade soup or a fish finger sandwich.
Yeah. Yes,
absolutely.
Yes.
What's wrong with
simple
that?
Simple is best.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And I think we've all got into this thing of actually eating out when you don't need to eat out.
Mm.
You go to the theatre, and my people say, "Are we going to eat first?" And I'm thinking, well, for me, the highlight of the evening is the theatre.
Mm-hmm.
I don't need to go out. If I'm going out for a meal in a restaurant, that's the highlight of my evening.
Mm.
The meal in the restaurant.
Absolutely.
Everything else is fodder. Everything else is fuel.
Mm.
If I'm out at home, nothing relaxes me more than being in the kitchen. And I think that's one of the things that I absolutely love about Nigel Slater and the way he does things. There are things I don't like about Nigel Slater. We'll get onto those later.
Oh, yes.
We're going to be really contentious there.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to go to a break now. When we come back, I'm going to talk to Bryony about her book, which Grow Happy, Cook Happy and Be Happy.
Yep.
I have to say, you always seem so happy. So thank obviously you. Growing and cooking works.
They are my pleasure in life.
We will see you after these ads. Look out, we're here for you. Look out, we're here for you. Welcome back to Look Out with me, Andrew Kay. My guests today, Andrew, Bryony, and Giles. Bryony.
Yes.
Oh, sometimes I'm at home and I'm sitting there talking to friends on Facebook and up pops a picture of your garden, followed by a picture of something you've prepared from your garden. And I have to put it down and go in the kitchen and make something to eat. You just, I mean, you could actually be sponsored by Alka-Seltzer or Gaviscon. You must prompt so many people to get in that kitchen and get cooking again.
Well,
and at strange times of the night. Have you always been a passionate cook? I know you're a very, very talented artist as well, illustrator, and now you work more as a painter than prior to that.
I paint when the inspiration is there. I might not paint for years. In fact, when Jimmy, my husband, was ill and things, I had no desire to paint, which is very sad. And then I've just started painting again in the last year or so and really enjoying it, but only when the feeling comes.
Yeah, I'm much the same. I mean, having studied at art school, it never leaves you. I went to Chelsea.
Oh, right.
But it's never gone. Mm. I use it now in the same way that I go to the kitchen to relax.
Yep.
I use painting as a way to relax. It's not always relaxing. When it's going well, it's relaxing, isn't it?
Well, it's fine. But it starts off fine, and then you get to a point and you think, do I go on? Do I leave it?
It's awful. Oh, the danger zone.
Go away, go in the garden, go for a walk, come back and battle through it. And you've got to go through that pain zone, and then hopefully it comes together again.
Now, whilst we're talking, I know Zahira in the gallery is going to pop up images. Some of them will be some of your paintings.
Thank you.
And some of them will be some of the food that you've done.
That's very kind.
But there are also one or two paintings of you with your husband. Now, your name is Bryony Hill, and for anyone who hasn't worked it out yet, your husband was perhaps the most iconic and famous football pundit of the last 50 years, Jimmy Hill. Mm-hmm. Who sadly passed away 3 years ago.
Yes.
But I don't think there'd be anyone who wouldn't know his name, because his fame spread far wider than just football, didn't it?
Well, I met him when I came back from having lived in France and I needed work, and the agency I was with said that there was this job opportunity. He was a BBC TV sports personality, and I said, who? And they said, Jimmy Hill, and I said, who? And I hadn't got a clue who he was, and I hate football. So I was the one person in England who didn't know him. It was quite scary.
But you'd been living in France. You're excused.
Yeah, I suppose so.
What were you doing in France?
Living.
Just living?
Yes, yes.
How exciting.
Yes.
God, I wish I could have done that at some point in my life. Mm. I think there is a generation that didn't understand the word gap year.
Mm.
Didn't
my gap year lasted five.
Lucky you.
Yes.
Lucky you.
Very happy five.
Now, you live out in Hurstbury Point. Mm-hmm. You're a Sussex girl.
I am.
Totally
born
a Sussex girl.
Yep.
But your passions these days are your garden and the food that you produce in your garden. And it's lavish. I mean, like myself, you live on your own.
Yes. Yes.
But you grow far more than you could possibly eat yourself. What do you do with it all?
I give it away and it's there for people who want it. And
you pickle, bottle.
I bottle, yep.
Fantastic.
Yes.
And your book, Grow Happy, Cook Happy, Be Happy. Mm-hmm. How's it done?
I think it's still doing well. But
turn it around, show everybody.
There we go.
It's lovely. but the premise is, this is about producing your food from soil to table.
It is, but you don't have to have a garden to do my recipes. Being on my own, my mother was widowed when she was 42, with three young people to bring up, and she had been a nurse. And she didn't want to fall into the trap of what she used to call bread and butter anemia, i.e. you have no desire to cook for yourself. It's so much easier to have a sandwich or a piece of toast or something, and then you have the problems that can come with that. And even up to the last few months of her life, she died at 84, she was still preparing food for herself, little dishes of this, little dishes of that, trying new experiments and things. And I've inherited that pleasure of making a meal part of the joy of the day, and a discipline as well, but not a chore. And I want to think that this book is equally accessible for people like us on their own. They can conjure up something out of virtually nothing and no big expense that's enjoyable even when you're on your own and not have someone to share it with.
Sometimes they're the most exciting meals. When you go into the kitchen and you look in the refrigerator and in the cupboard and you think, oh, there's a courgette.
Mike, this is
an onion. Charles, behave. It's not that sort of a show. But it is that thing, and you think, oh, I could, and I love that. And I also, I find it very funny when friends who have families and they say, well, it's all right for you, you're only cooking for one. And I'm thinking, how much longer does it take to stick four chops under the grill?
Exactly.
Than one? I mean, it takes me the same length of time to cook for one. Actually, possibly because I can't cook for one. I mean, you know, I've just finished a lasagna that would have fed 10.
Yep.
And I've had lasagna almost every day. I've frozen some of it, obviously. But you do end up making these big dishes, don't you?
Indeed.
And I think that's that's a discipline that I haven't learnt to create. The, you know, I make a salad and then finish it, and it's, and you think, it's two meals worth. What am I doing? Hence what I call the CV.
Yes.
It is very difficult cooking for one and making the right small amount. Charles, do you cook for yourself?
I don't too much, but because one of the reasons is because of that. Because I always overcook. And I'm always cooking for too many people. And this is the thing, even though there's nobody there. And I just cannot stand wasting food.
Oh, no, that's the worst thing in the world.
Having to sort of, like, throw anything away because it's been sitting for too long in the fridge. So sometimes that will actually impact
on
me.
I'm not too worried about things like that. I mean, I did a thing a few years ago about food waste and the terrifying fact that British households, if they shop, supermarket shop, 56%...
I don't do it.
..goes in the bin.
It's shocking.
People
big
buy
shop.
Be all the, you know, all these big bags of salad things, and it's a bag of slime in 3 days. I don't do that. You obviously don't do that, and you worry about that in the same way.
Because we've got these things, these food caddies from the council that we can put all the kind of compostable stuff in. That was such an enormous marker, I think, for a lot of people, including myself, when you sort of like were able to see physically the amount of food I wasn't eating, so I was just sort of going to throw that in the bin normally, but I put it into this little bin. And I was emptying that bin every other day.
That's ridiculous. See, I don't see food like that and think compost. I see food like that and think soup.
I was just going to say soup.
Soup. And I've been known to serve salad soup. And people say, salad soup.
Makes the
soup.
Best gazpacho.
It makes the best gazpacho. But even in the winter, you can actually make great soup with salad. You know, when you've dressed it for dinner party, and the next morning you look at it, it's all sad and soggy. It still makes great soup. Fantastic. You know, a little bit of vegetable bouillon. Get your stick blender out. And there it is. And you don't throw it away. I mean, I've made savoury bread and butter pudding with leftover sandwiches after a party. And it's wonderful. A load of whole ham and cheese sandwiches that were left. And I just thought, I'll just make a savoury custard and pour it on and a bit of grated cheese.
Croquemousse,
Absolutely. No waste. I can't bear waste. Everything gets reused. Even leftover Yorkshire puddings, not that there are often leftover Yorkshire puddings, there's no such thing as something we'll come on to with Nigel later. But those jam on a cold Yorkshire pudding. Oh, one of the best things in the world.
I don't think I've ever known a meal where there's been a leftover Yorkshire pudding.
No, I know.
How does that happen, where you've actually got leftover Yorkshire
pudding? It's
very
odd, isn't it?
Yeah. Don't you just eat them?
Although I am totally offended when I go to restaurants, and I must confess, my pet hate is Sunday lunch in pubs, because they tend to put too much on your plate and they drown everything in gravy and they give you Yorkshire puddings with pork, lamb and chicken. Well, I'm sorry, I'm old-fashioned.
It's beef.
I don't want them with pork, lamb or chicken. I want them with beef. And with pork, I want applesauce. And with chicken, I want sage and onion stuffing. And with lamb, I want mint sauce. Never red currant cherry. Horrible stuff. Why would you put red currant jelly?
Because it goes very nicely.
It goes very nicely with lamb.
No, it's rude. It's dirty.
A nice
food and red
dirty.
Currant jelly. Yeah.
I like my the traditional things. Like that.
A divisive issue there.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah, like I think it's three against one there, Andrew.
I think the red currant jelly thing is the fact that our palates have become more in tune with sweet things.
Mm. Possibly. That's
what do you meet in the middle with mint jelly, Andrew?
No, I don't
no,
mint
chili
either.
Mint sauce.
I go the into vinegar. The garden and make my own mint sauce every time.
But absolutely. Then you don't taste the lamb.
Don't put a lot of it and don't put a lot of vinegar in it.
No. Right, a bit more water.
It's half water, half vinegar,
lots of sugar.
And some sugar.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's the sweetness.
It works really well. Mm-hmm. It's really nice. It's really good fun. It's a wonderful book.
Thank
I mean,
you.
I'm so pleased for you that it's worked. And the response that it had, I watch online how people... They come to you and ask for advice.
I know, and still I'm getting reviews and things like that. It's overwhelming because I never thought that I did anything any differently from other people, but...
You do?
I don't know. It's just food I like eating, which is why I don't often go to restaurants, because I'd rather cook and eat my own food. Because it's not
good
fussy.
News for you, Andrew,
no.
But well, good news for people who want to cook at home.
No, give them
well,
the chance.
Absolutely. I'm terrified we've got at the prospect now, or Alan should be at least.
We've got to go to a break. When we come back, we'll be talking to Giles about toast.
Lovely. And
salty butter, probably. See you after these ads. Look out. We're here for you. Hello, welcome back to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay, and my guests, Andrew, Bryony, and Giles. Giles, you're here in Brighton, appearing in Toast. Now, Toast is the stage version of Nigel Slater's book,
yes.
Which was a strange mix of fiction and autobiography.
It's predominantly autobiography.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He really, it's, you know, everything...
But written in a story-like manner.
It is. I mean, what he does very cleverly, and, well, not cleverly, it's one of the reasons Nigel Slater is so loved, is he weaves in food throughout the whole book. So
absolutely.
Every single chapter is named after a food, and a food of pertinent to that exact moment in his childhood. And
now,
of course...
I love what Nigel does. I love his recipes. I love the programmes. And I think everything he stands for is brilliant, but I do have one thing that really winds me up about him, and that is something that most TV chefs do, which is have a camera at the back of the refrigerator, and they open the door and they film it as if you're in the fridge, which is nuts, isn't it? And Nigel will open the door. And one episode, he said, there's nothing I like more on a Tuesday than opening the refrigerator and finding a leftover lobster tail. Now, who has a leftover lobster tail? They don't exist, do they? He also fries eggs in a very peculiar manner. It's almost sexual. He flicks fat over them as if he's caressing them. And then he takes them out with such reverence and places them on a slice of toast. And you think, Nigel, get real, it's an egg on toast.
It's not reverence, it's disgust. He can't bear them. He absolutely loathes eggs.
Absolutely amazing. That explains an awful lot. Because, I mean, eggs are vital in what we do as cooks.
Mm. Mm.
Vital. I mean, they're in so many things. Mm. They're in desserts. They're in savoury courses.
I have six chickens.
You've got six chickens?
Yep.
Wonderful.
When an egg is sort of included in a cake,
he's okay with
that.
You
can't hold Nigel back. He loves cake. Absolutely loves it. And he will say that, you know, but when it's like on an, you know, a fried egg or a scrambled egg or something horrific like that, like, won't touch
such
it.
A shame. What a loss in your life. Well, listen, let's take a quick look at the show. We've got a trail.
Okay.
And we can take a look at that. So, Hero, run that VT for me, please.
It's impossible not to love someone who makes you toast. People's failings, even major ones, like pouring too much water in the jam tart mix, disappear as you break through the toasted crust. Get to the doughy cushion of white underneath. It can be thick or thin, crisp or soft, gold or brown or black or a bit of all three. But like bedsheets and underpants, a perfect piece of toast can only ever be white. Mum says brown bread toast is for old people. Old people who suddenly decide they should look after themselves a bit more. Burnt. Mum burns the toast as surely as the sun rises every morning. In fact, I doubt she's ever made a round of toast in her whole life that hasn't completely filled the kitchen with smoke. It is impossible not to love someone who makes you toast.
I have to say, it does look absolutely wonderful. And it, even just seeing the short clips there reminds me so much of reading the book the first time when it first came out and how much I enjoyed it. How difficult is it being Nigel? Because he's been very involved. I mean, you've met him many times. Mm. He comes along.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, is he critical? Does he say, you know, the way you do this isn't Nigel?
No, he's only ever been supportive, and he's so passionate and believes in the show and loves it. When he arrived for me on day one of rehearsals, it was terrifying. And I had to sort of hide in the corner of the rehearsal room going, I can't believe he's here, why is he here? But he came so often.
That is really intimidating, up on the first day of rehearsal.
It was, but I mean, actually, it became such a reassuring thing that he's sort of one of the cast now, he's one of the company, essentially, and he will pop up on tour at different venues and things like that and come to support us. And the only note he's ever given me, which was passed through my director, was the way I was pronouncing maraschino cherries.
And how should it be
pronounced? I was saying maraschino, which is the Italian way, but he says he would always say maraschino.
Of course he would. He's a nice, well-brought-up home counties boy, isn't he?
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, how old are you at the start of the play?
Nine.
Nine?
Oh, my goodness.
Hence the flannel shorts.
Which and filled the long me socks.
Fill me with absolute horror. The memories of being a schoolboy in flannel shorts, that walking to school in the rain, they would get wet and then you'd have chapped knees. Mm-hmm. That's not a word you hear very often these days, is it, the word chapped? I don't think it exists. I think it's because young people don't wear shorts in the same way in the winter.
The postmen do.
They do, don't they?
They do.
They're hardy breed, postmen in Brighton. Yes, definitely. It must be great fun. I know when the show was in London, as part of the performance, some of the things that he passionate about and talked about, like lemon meringue pie and walnut whips, would be passed out to the audience. But apparently on tour, we're not having that treat.
Not some of the things that happened in London, sadly, are not with us anymore, but we still do leap into the audience at various different points and hand out some treats. So don't worry, you will be getting something if you come to the show.
Fantastic. Well, on that basis, because I'd heard that I wasn't getting treats, I've brought treats along for everyone today, including some of my favourite things. So we have sherbet lemons, drumstick lollies, which I love. Pull your fillings out. They're terrible things, aren't they? Love hearts.
Awkward.
Marshmallows.
Delicious.
Which are good, aren't they? I'm not going to pop that one in my mouth, but I'll put it there because I've touched it. There are some fruit pastels and some lollies, but how to split the nation.
Yeah.
Brexit, forget it. It's Palmer Violets. Mm-hmm. Now, this is your onstage prop, isn't
it? It is. It's my onstage prop.
I'm going to pass those down and you can help yourself.
I will take a lemon sherbet for later.
Excellent.
Lovely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Drumstick for me.
Definitely.
Definitely.
Pass it back. So, Palmer Violets, tell us about Palmer Violets. I mean, they're old, aren't they?
Palmer Violets are very, I mean, they're just, you know, people absolutely love them or hate them, but there's a very key moment in the show. Like I said, you know, earlier, Nigel's so much food that we know and love and remember. There's so much nostalgia in the play. There's a whole sequence where I start talking about butterscotch angel delight.
Oh,
and it stops everyone in their tracks. In the audience, they just go,
angel delight.
Yes,
but have you revisited it in the last few years?
I have.
Because the weird thing is, it's changed. It doesn't taste the same. And maybe it's a memory thing. Mm. Someone for my 60th birthday gave me all the flavours of angel delight. What do you buy someone fat? 60th Angel Delight, of course. The strawberry tasted the same. The vanilla was a bit revolting. The butterscotch, which I had such fond memories of.
That's the one.
It wasn't the same.
No.
It wasn't the same. And it could be that time has changed your memory of it.
But you can buy them pre-made now.
Well, that's silly. Oh,
I know. They come in little tubs. I mean, you know, that's just the whole magic of it is
it's making it.
It's not
the winning and everything, absolutely. Yeah.
I love shows where there's food involved. I can remember going to London to see Vincent in Brixton, and the cast were on the set as you went in, and the lady who ran the boarding house that Vincent went on, Vincent van Gogh, as my Dutch friends will correct. She was on stage roasting lamb, live on stage. Now, I travelled up from Brighton, arrived at the theatre just in time, not having had dinner, to sit through 2.5 hours of theatre with the smell of roast lamb and gravy being made was deadly. And then, of course, you come out of the theatre and you've got a dash to Victoria. No time to get anything to eat. It was agonising. And is there live cooking on stage with us?
Oh, yes, there is.
Excellent.
And also, there's a lot of sensorial experience as well. I won't give too much away, but similar to that, the first thing you smell when you walk into the auditorium, hopefully, is toast.
Toast.
Oh, how lovely.
Yeah.
Fab. How lovely.
Sometimes it is.
I know at Chichester when they did Love Story as a musical, which was beautiful, they cooked in real time a tomato pasta dish on stage from scratch whilst singing. And I thought...
Singing?
Yes.
Goodness.
Okay,
and I thought,
that's pushing it a little bit too far, isn't it?
So absolutely. You don't have to sing and dance while you're
doing it. Don't have to sing and dance. We do have a lot of movement in the show. Our director and choreographer did a lot of work with Frantic Assembly, who people will know... Yes. Probably for their work with Curious Instance, the dog in the middle of the night time. And so when the show opens, people go, oh, wait a minute, is this Nigel Slater the musical? It isn't, but there's a lot of wonderful movement because the story tracks from Nigel age 9 right through to kind of his early sort of teen, 20s, I should say.
Yeah.
And in doing so, we have to move around and kind of
You've got to get out of the shorts for a start.
Get out of the shorts, get into some trousers, absolutely, and see some of his adventures, basically.
And some of his knees.
And some of his knees.
I'm not giving anything away, though, of course. Well, we're going to go to a break now. When we come back, we'll talk generally about our love and passion for food and find out a little bit more about what you're doing, what you're going to be writing next.
Okay.
And... what you hope to be doing in the future as well, which I'm sure will be very interesting. Maybe not so food-related. Apologies to Nigel if you get to see this. I do love you, really, despite the egg thing and the lobster nonsense. We'll see you after these ads.
Look out! Look out! We're here for you.
Hello, welcome back to Look Out with Andrew Kay. My guests today have been Andrew Mosley, Bryony Hill, and Giles Cooper. And we've been gorging ourselves in the break while you've been watching ads. We've been eating sweeties, so everyone's teeth are gummed together. Actually, I noticed Bryony very sensibly has popped her lemon sherbet in her handbag. Oh, and it's on your knee. But later. I love them. But they do make your tongue sore, don't they?
Yes, time spent on research.
Yeah. I really wanted to bring walnut whips in, but I searched the shops around here. Apparently, the only place you can reliably buy them is Marks and Spencer's. My memory of walnut whips is that they were a real treat, because growing up growing up in the 60s, pocket money was scant. I mean, I can remember the lady in the corner shop giving me a threepenny bit and telling me not to spend it all at once on my holidays. And of course, the threepenny bit back then bought quite a lot of sweets, didn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I can remember you could get 4 chews for a penny.
For a penny,
if you didn't have a penny, you could buy 1 for a farthing or 2 for a halfpenny.
2 for a halfpenny, I can remember.
3 for 3 farthings. There you go.
We're sounding so old.
I am old.
No, I'm amounting to nothing. Other than the half crown I used to get from my pocket money.
I can remember Mum also saying to me, you can have some money for sweets, but you mustn't buy a lucky bag. Do you remember lucky bags?
No.
It must have been a Lancashire thing. A lucky bag was a paper bag, a sort of weird, sort of slightly shiny paper. And in it, there was absolute rubbish.
Yeah.
And about 3 tiny sweets. Then usually be something like a little plastic rocket that was a cap rocket. You probably don't know what caps are either, do you? And you put these little explosive paper things
oh,
in.
Oh, yes.
And you'd throw this rocket at the ground and it would explode. They were terrible, but my God, the lure of this thing and not knowing what was inside, it was far more exciting than...
I remember them.
The other things.
If you wanted value, it was fruit salads and blackjacks.
Fruit salads and blackjacks. Yeah.
Hundreds of these things for about 20 pence. Yeah,
well, they were, as Brian, he says, four for a penny when I was little. And a penny would buy you quite a lot of sweets, and you'd get to go home from school with these, you know,
think,
oh, this is exciting. we all have secret vices. I mean, my secret vices are sherbet fountains and Fry's Turkish Delight, which on one level is pretty repellent, but on another level is completely Moorish. What's your secret vice, food-wise?
Oh, that's tricky. I will always go for a crunchy bar.
Good choice.
Or even better, that burnt toffee. These are cinder toffee.
Yeah,
from the old sweet Briony. Shops.
If it was a sweet, finger of fudge.
Really?
And if it was food, cheese. The show once, and they
sang that a finger of fudge is just enough to lure them off the street, which I don't think were the real lyrics of the song. Andrew, what's your secret vice?
It's got to be double decker for me.
Oh, really?
Double decker, love those.
Oh, my goodness.
You still have a double decker from time to time.
Double deckers are great value,
aren't they? Stop at the
garage
on the way. Kev, a double decker.
But they're good value because they're bigger than all the other bars for about the same price, aren't they?
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, you can get double size of pretty much everything now.
Really?
Basically, because they've made the original small. So if you now want... if you now want the original, it's a double, isn't it?
No,
everything's been trimmed back.
Don't like things
being
made smaller for economic reasons. Just charge me a little bit more. Give me what I want. Yeah. I don't like it when they change recipes as well. I think that's really upsetting. Mm. When something that's been a favourite for years and years...
Like
and
a marathon.
They write on it, new recipe. And I'm thinking, no! Don't want it changing. Now, Bridie... You've written a recipe book, but who's your favourite food writer? You can say Nigel.
I'm old school. I think Nigel's wonderful. I love Floyd.
Floyd.
Yeah. He was just amazing on all points. His television programmes, everything. It was just, he had such fun. And a troubled man, but very complex. But I think his food, it was... It's the sort of food that I would like to be able to do myself. It was done from the heart. And he wanted to learn, and I want to learn. I'm not a cook. I love food, therefore I eat what I like, cook what I like to eat. But I think Floyd, probably, and Nigel, but I
spent a fantastic, very drunken night in Brighton.
With Keith Floyd, did you?
Not the whole night, it's not that sort of a story. But we had the evening together as an event.
How
and
super.
I sat on the table with him, and I've not laughed so much or drunk so much whiskey in my life. It was crazy. You don't cook very often, but do you have a favourite recipe book that you resort to? Or have you got everything now by Nigel signed?
In triple.
Yes.
Funnily enough, I was a fan of Nigel before I even got this show. I was absolutely... Because it's so easy, and he always encourages you to just...
Play, not measure.
All the recipes are a guide, a rough guide. But just, you know, add as much butter or as much of this or as much of that as you
There's
want.
There's no such thing kind of as too much butter. Except for in cakes. Andrew, do you have a favourite food writer?
I'm going to strip it back to my university days because I trained as a hotel manager, but part of the course was cooking. And so we were issued the book by Cesarani and Keaton.
Oh, yes.
You know, how to make sole meuniere.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
You know, grill your sole and melt butter. And then there'd be a separate little recipe piece on the amount of butter and how to melt it. It's pretty straightforward.
So do you remember...
But the basic stuff was in there. You know, how to trim meat, how to cut fish, how to...
It's a wonderful book.
Incredible. How to make basic roux and sauces and soups and, you know, and then you kind of read... all of the great recipe book writers, and you think, as long as you've got the basics, you can start to be creative. So
to the horror of my art history lecturers were horrified when I wrote an essay at Chelsea School of Art on the different designs of fried potatoes that I'd found in a selection of books, including Larousse. But I found about 36 different ways of cutting potatoes and then frying them, which I thought was wonderful. I mean, that's a real design... issue,
absolutely.
Isn't it? I love that. My favourite recipe book, and it's the one that I turn to over and over again, was written by a wonderful TV presenter called Dorothy Slightholm. And she was the farmhouse lady who did the farmhouse kitchen for Yorkshire TV.
Kitchen.
And Dorothy Slytherin is my hero. She was brilliant. Mm-hmm. And the books are full of recipes from women's institutes, mm-hmm. and from friends. And there are three volumes.
I never saw the programme because of living in Sussex or wherever. But I've got the book.
Book's
and I bought it from a book club magazine. You know, you bought so many books per month, and you got four for a pound.
Yeah.
And that book has been used more than all the others because of pickle recipes and traditional apple puddings. And
puddings,
as you say, there, Mrs. So and So from whatever.
Do you remember Marguerite Patton?
Yes.
Oh,
Cookery and Colour.
Marguerite Patton lived in Hove, and I had dinner with her once.
Yeah. Mm. So the show opens with me reading Cookery and Colour, because that was the book that Nigel grew up on.
Yes, that's my first cookery book.
There's a whole section where I read certain recipes, mm-hmm. and there's a recipe for, well, just basically, you know, how to prepare asparagus, mm-hmm.
yes.
and she recommends that you boil it for 25 minutes.
There you go.
I can and that's a long time.
Marguerite Patton, Marguerite Patton invented a fabulous wartime recipe for salad green that didn't use eggs, I think. It was most bizarre. But until a few years ago, she was still very active around Brighton Hove, and I went to a few events and sat next to her at dinner, and she was just a complete delight. Mm-hmm. And I think you're right, she is one of the great cooks. And in a way, you sort of have to miss Fanny Craddock, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
For the lunacy of
the Galloping Gourmet. And
the Galloping Gourmet.
It was when she put the mushrooms into the duck, wasn't it, or something like that?
Oh,
was
it? It was when she burnt it. She did a dish, didn't she? And eventually she stopped off set because she burnt it, right? And everyone had to come with some of the cold flannels and things to calm her down.
There's a horrible, legendary sketch.
Oh, the awful poor girl.
Yes.
And she did something terrible on, I think it was either on Pebble Mill or Nationwide, involving donuts, which I can't tell on television, but I'll tell you when we finish recording the show. And we've not got very much time left, so most urgently, toast. Theatre Royal this week.
Theatre Royal, we are open tonight, and we play until...
In fact, you opened last night because of the magic of television.
Magic of television, I'm so sorry. Last night, and and we're now running till the 2nd of November, which is Saturday, and with matinees on Thursday and Saturday. One or two tickets left. So
worth
come
booking.
On down. Absolutely.
Bryony, how can people get hold of your book?
Order it from any good bookshop, order it online, or me, whatever, or from the publisher.
And your publisher is Red Door.
In Berkshire,
Andrew,
yes.
When is the Chef's Table event?
Wednesday, the 20th of November, in the Empress Suite at the Grand. Tickets are £120 each. It goes to charity, Rocking Horse, which is a fantastic cause.
We love the Rocking Horse.
It's very limited. There's only 200 seats at the dinner.
It'll sell out.
So you need to call Brighton 224 300 and go to option two.
Brilliant. Thank you all so much for coming in today. I'm absolutely ravenous now. I'm just going to have to tuck into the sweetie. Can't
awesome
decide what I'm going to have next, but I think it might have to be a drumstick. Over to you, Jules. Thank you so much. Pass them on.
Mm. Ooh. I should take another.
Drumstick jellies. They're pretty.
Another lemon.
Great.
What's
I'm
it?
Go
there we go.
What a way to spend the day. Fantastic. Right. I'll see you at the theatre tomorrow evening. And I won't wave and distract you. But if you're handing out freebies, then, you know, I'll probably be in row F, seat warm.
Excellent.
Marvellous. Excellent. Thanks for watching. See you again next week. Yum.
Look out. Look out. We're here for you. The bottom.